Sure is good to be in God's house this evening. Good, in a nice, cool, comfortable place. I'm going to be reading out of Luke chapter 14. A few other places, but Luke chapter 14. I'm going to read a verse here before we start. We were talking about the Spirit of God, or what we all should have. It says, "Now to him that is able to do exceeding abundantly above all that we ask or think, according to," and then people leave this part out, "according to the power that worketh in us." Most people leave that part out, that it's the power that we have in us because we receive it. And we'll have to receive it to have any power. You know, when you get saved, in my case, my dog knew it. And there were some people around me knew it that knew me. But it's serious business. Now, we don't want to quench the Holy Ghost in here. We want the Lord to move and help us. And let me pray first. Lord, I thank you, Lord, for saving me. Thank you for everything that you've done, even with these peoples that showed up here tonight. Lord, we thank you for everything you've done in their life, Lord. We thank you for answered prayer, and we pray, Lord, for those that have been asked that you would answer them. And Lord, we pray, Lord, that you would answer them for your honor and glory, Lord, that you get praise and honor and glory out of everything be done here, even this evening. Thank you for everything you're doing. We pray that you would bless the word of God as it goes forth. I pray, Lord, that you'd help me be mindful of what I can say that would help somebody. I want to help somebody tonight. And I pray, Lord, that you would send conviction on hearts and minds as to their standing in you, and that we have no life outside of Jesus. And I want you to convey that to them as they sit and listen. Lord, give them ears to hear what the Spirit saith unto them. And Lord, we thank you for all that you're doing and what you're going to do tonight. Lord, we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, we want to ask in chapter 14 of Luke, over chapter and verse 16. In the book of Luke, chapter 14, verse 16. Everybody ready? Then said he unto him, "A certain man made a great supper and bade many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidden, Come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have bought five yoke of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have married a wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, Go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, and yet there is room. And the Lord said unto the servant, Go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come in, that my house may be filled. For I say unto you that none of those men which were bidden shall taste of my supper." You can be seated. Well, I'm going to preach on, are you saved? I used to ask that question to everybody I run into. When I first got saved, I'd run up to them, you know. I was had zeal. I was really excited. And I said, "Have you ever been born again?" And he said, "I got born right the first time." And you'll hear all kinds of crazy answers to what you got. But they don't know what went on and what takes place when the new birth happens. And they don't understand it because they've been blinded. The God of this world has blinded their mind. And that's what's happens. They can't see it. Except a man repent, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And that's what happens. You don't have no repentance. I mean, you're just going along lickety-split, living your life like you want to live. But Paul said in the book of Corinthians, he said, "Godly sorrow worketh repentance unto salvation, not to be repented of, but the sorrow of the world worketh death." And so you're going to have to be sorry to God. God is who we're going to have to answer to. He took our place. He's paid the sin debt for everybody. It's whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. It's for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but that all should have eternal life. But these people right here, they have made excuses, and that's why people don't get saved. They've always got an excuse why they didn't get saved. You know, that, well, there are plenty of people. I've been in this church since 1943, and I pay my church tithes. I give a lot of money. I support 40 ministers, missionaries, and he's got a lot of reasons why he is saved, because he supports the church. He's faithful to the church. But these people had all kinds of excuses. This first one had a piece of ground, and he already bought it. He didn't go look at it. It might have had sinkholes in it, chug holes, rocks. We don't know what was wrong with it. He don't know what was wrong with that land, but he said, I done bought a piece of ground, and I'm going to go, I got to go take a look at it. I've got to. It's a must. And but you know, you may have something you want to go look at, and you may not have the opportunity, you know, because you're not promised one the next day. The Bible says to boast not thyself of tomorrow, for you know not what one day may bring forth. You know, you may wind up down there where the preacher went tonight. You know, you might be the best time you ever looked good was down there. And you know what I'm saying? This would be the last rolling down, be the last roll. So you better make preparations for your eternal being, because it's going to be forever. Exactly. It's forever, friends. This is just a veil. The Lord tells us a lot of times in there. He said, we're a shadow, and we're just a vapor. He illustrates and gives an analogy of what we are as human life. It's but a vapor. It's a shadow. And life is short, is what I'm saying. We don't know when we're going to live out here. We don't know when we're going to move out. And so the Bible says to be ye also ready, for you know not when the Son of Man cometh. So we got the signs when he's coming. He could be today, but you could go before this evening's out. Okay, this fellow, he had a piece of ground, and he wanted to go look at it. And then he bought five oxen, and he went to prove them. So he wanted to go work the oxen, this other fellow that he asked to come to the supper. And he didn't know if what kind of oxen he got, if they'd work or if they could be yoked up or whatever. And the other one said, since he had a wife, he just flatly said, hey, I ain't going to be there. I'm not coming. And that's the way most people are, you know, that a lot of people are. Yeah. Now, you won't see me. You'll see me down at the church house when you see me coming in the parking lot. That's the only time you'll see me coming. They used to knock on my door and come in and ask me. And that's what I told him when I was a lost man. And I said, that's what I told him. I said, and I lived in the back door of the church, a church. And I said, when you see me coming, it's when I'll be there. Now, ain't that sorry? I thought about that every time. They would come every week to talk to me. But I had an experience when I was just a little boy about going to church, and I used it all my life as being saved in a Southern Baptist church. Now that's the way a lot of people are too. In my age, they've been got a counterfeit. They thought they got saved, and they used that, and they took them down there, and got them baptized, got them wet. All they got was wet, yeah. And then told them they were saved, and then they lived like they wanted to the rest of their life, lived like the devil themselves. But one day I heard the word. It came to me. I kept hearing it. I just got in church and started hearing. You know, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. And I didn't know nothing about it, but I just heard it. And he preached it real nice. I liked it. But he didn't preach it. Some of it I didn't like. You know what I'm saying? Because he told me I was a sinner. But I found out that all was a sinner. Bible says, for all have come sin and come short of the glory of God. He says, there's none righteous, no, not one. And you're not righteous out there. The only righteousness you've got is a filthy rank. The only righteousness you got is in Jesus. If you give your heart to Jesus. And the Bible says to keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. And that's why you get in trouble too. The way I get in trouble, it's our heart. Even Jeremiah said, the heart is deceitful and desperately wicked above all. Who can know it? Well, God knows your heart. He knows the hair on your head. You know that God will still save you. You know, if you've been playing church and being in a church, you know, there's a lot of people in the church house. And you would think that there's so many people in the church house that got saved that they'd be out telling somebody something if they got it. I mean, do you have enough power, as that verse said, it says, looking to him, the author of faith, looking to him who do exceedingly abundantly above all we ever ask or think according to the power that worketh in us. So do you think you got enough power to tell somebody you got saved? Do you tell anybody about your Jesus? How much do you know about Jesus? Do you tell them about Jesus down there at the store? Down there at the grocery store? Hey, they need to hear it. Because they're going to burn in hell. You know, the rich man, he'd like to have a little water out here today in this yard here. But you know, he's in hell today. He's got all his faculties. He can hear, smell, taste, touch, and talk. He's going to say, go tell my brother not to come here to this place. Hell's a bad place. It's where there's weeping and wailing and gnashing of teeth. It's where the fire is not quenched and the worm dieth not. It's forever. It's just like it was compared to a landfill that burned constantly. It was just a smoldering bodies. Hell's bad. Hell is bad news, and hell is real. They said, well, God wouldn't do us that way. God's a good God. He wouldn't send us to hell. But it's because they don't know God. He says he's angry with the wicked every day. It says here in verse 21, here it says, so that servant came and showed his Lord these things. Then the master of the house, being angry, said to his servant, go out quickly into the streets and lanes of the city and bring them in hither, the poor, the maimed, the halt, and the blind. He was angry because it was already said for him. It was just fixed. You know, that's what Jesus said. It is finished. And that's the way it was. It was finished on the cross. He took your debt. He took your sin, my sin, and nailed it on the cross. The Bible says, for he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we could be made the righteousness of God in him. And that's the only righteousness you've got, is the righteousness that Jesus gave to you. But through the blood. Through the precious blood. Peter called it the precious blood. It's precious, all right. It's precious. It's holy. It's unspotted. It's something that this world don't know nothing about. I want you to get it in. And get in too. Because you need Jesus. And if you ain't got enough Jesus to talk about him, you need to start reading your Bible. You know that? Don't you know that? The Bible says the Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward. He's patient. Not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And we need to repent. Repent's a big word. Nobody talks about that nowadays, but that means turning away. Don't do that no more. But Lord, forgive me for doing that. And then in your mind you're saying, until the next time. That's not repentance. Repentance is not doing it. Repentance is give it to God and he understands you and you're sincere enough and he is too and he lets you go because he paid the sin debt forever. But he wants you to have fellowship and he wants to be your children because you are one of his. You're a child of the king, friend. I'm telling you, when you're a child of the king, you got privileges. You got a lot of privileges nobody's got. And that, you know, that song says when we all get to heaven, you know, we all ain't going to go to heaven. The Bible says few there be that find it. It says strive to enter in at the straight gate. To strive, it says. So we all be striving. And I want you to know that there is a way that seemeth right unto a man. There's a way that if you're lost in here and been in church all your life, you said, the Bible says there is a way that seemeth right unto a man, but the end thereof are the ways of death. That's sad. We think we're doing right, and we don't. We think it's okay, but we never did get the new birth. And Paul said, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He says, old things are passed away. And he says, behold, all things are become new. And that's the way it is when you get saved. It all becomes new. There's a new look at the flowers, trees. You can see God around you when you got him. When he comes in here and says, look out there. Look here what I made for you. Look here what an opportunity you got over here. Look here what you can do. And look what I made, and look here, you're just a part of it. And we ought to glorify God because He loves us. Religion and salvation are not the same. There are many religions. You know, there's all kinds. Everybody's got. There, you can find all kinds of religion. You just search around. You'll find out there's some things out there you wouldn't ever thought was available. Since people want to try to believe something, they got people have their own gods. They got their little gods, their bass boats, and their gods they got. But salvation is knowing the Lord Jesus as Savior by faith. The Bible says, "For by grace through faith are you saved, and that not of yourselves. It is a gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast." So we're saved by grace through faith. That's the way it is. And salvation's from sin and from hell comes only through the shed blood of the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says, without the shedding of blood, there's no remission. Well, so there's five things you ought to know. I was telling you about, we're making excuses. I don't think we ought to have an excuse. We ought to try to get rid of the excuses we got for our own walk with God. We ought to try to eliminate them, pray about it, and get closer to God, and myself included. This message is for me. And there's five things you ought to know. That you're going to die. It's the first thing is that you're going to die. You're going to leave out of this world. The Bible says, "For it is appointed in a man once to die, and after this, the judgment." So you're going to die. You're going to have to stand before the judgment seat of God and or Christ, and then you won't have to stand at the great white throne judgment. If you're lost, you'll have to stand at the great white throne judgment, which is bad news, to be cast into the lake of fire. The Bible's Romans 5:12 says, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned." And then, so death is coming, and you cannot save yourself. The Bible says, not by works of righteousness, which we have done, but according to His mercy He saved us, by the washing of the regeneration of the Holy Ghost, which He shed on us abundantly through the Lord Jesus Christ. I've given you a lot of scripture here. I hope you're picking up some of it. It's you're begotten by the Word. I hope you get the Word. The Word was made flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld His glory. The glory is of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The law came by Moses. You know, people trying to keep the law. The law came by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. And it's all Jesus. It's all Jesus. Amen. Okay, you're dead. You're going to die. You cannot save yourself, and only Jesus can save you. "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh to the Father but by me." And then in Acts 4:12, he says, "Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved." None other. I mean, they can come up with any strange foreign name, whatever they want to get salvation, but it's Jesus. It's Jesus. The one Jesus, the Jesus of Nazareth. There'll be kinds that aren't Jesus. They've come up with a lot of Jesuses, but there's just one. There's just one. And you must pray and accept Jesus to save you. "But as many as received Him, to them gave He the power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on His name," it says. And it says, it's a free gift right there. You know, if you'll pray and ask Jesus to save you, He'll save you. If you're sincere in your heart, He'll save you because He loves you, because He first loved you. He said, "I've come to seek and to save that which was lost." He says, "A thief cometh but for to steal, but I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly." Amen. The thief cometh but to steal and destroy, but I am come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. And you can have an abundant life. See, even a Christian can have an abundant life. If you get more of Jesus, you'll have more abundant life. Because that's our life. Hey, our life is hid in God. Hey, we don't have no life outside of Jesus. I want you to know that. That's the main thing. You're dead. You're like a zombie. You know that zombie shell they used to show on the screen? You're dead. You're just like it. I mean, you're the same as just walking to the graveyard. That's the same as what you are if you don't have Jesus. It's all in vain. Your life's in vain. I talked with a fella. His wife died. She had cancer. This is in my family. He had cancer. And his son died. He had to have bypass surgery, cut open, you know. And he's looking to live to be 100 now. And it's just frivolous. You know, it's just one step to another. Thank God, you know. Do they thank God? Do they have a care for God, how he works in their life? You know, do they give praise God? It's sad. When you're lost, it's a sad predicament. You have no one to turn to. Nobody ever cared for me like Jesus. He's a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Okay, and five. When am I going to do it? When am I going to get saved? How long are you going to wait till you get saved? When do I do it? When am I going to do it? The Bible says today is the day of salvation. Now is the accepted time. So you may need to get saved this night. And I've given you enough words to tell you that you're in trouble if you're not saved. So you better be thinking about it. It's serious business. It is a fearful thing to fall into the hands of the living God. He's a living God. And it's fearful. And I hope fear goes on you. I hope fear comes on you. Conviction of the heart that your salvation is null and void. That you'll run to Jesus. You need to run to Jesus. He's your helper. He's the one that loves you. And he'll take it. He'll take it and give you everlasting life. You'll have everlasting life, but you want it to be with Jesus. If there's anyone who wants to come to the altar and pray, I know everybody has trouble and family members in trouble. I know I do. We'll have a little prayer before we leave here. And I think it'd be a good idea for all of us to pray for the church. We thank for all the visitors that's come here tonight. We thank for all of them. And we pray, Lord, the Lord to give them traveling mercies as they travel back to where they're going. And that you'd bless them, bless their families, everything that was mentioned here tonight. And we want to pray for Brother Lawson. Brother Scott, wait a second, prayer.
Father, we're so thankful we can come to you with our burdens. We can come to you, God, knowing that you hear us, you love us, and nothing takes you by surprise. Lord, pray for every soul in this building. God, if there's be one lost, right now, things open your heart, Lord, and invite you in, that you'd make a new creature out of it, that you'd write their name in the Lamb's Book of Life, let you walk out a new creature, God. Lord, we're so thankful that salvation is free. God, we love you because you first loved us. We can't help but love you the more we learn about you, God, how you have our good and your intentions. You've crossed time and eternity, God, to redeem us, and how grateful we are to you, God, for being our Savior. Lord, and help us to make it that you're our Master and Lord. Lord, I pray that you be Lord of my life. Forgive me, Lord, where I have failed you. I have failed this church. I failed my family. Lord, I failed my employer. I have failed miserably, God. But I pray, God, that you would lift me up and help. Lord, I pray for those that are sick, Lord, those that need healing. Lord, myself included, God, that we need a touch from you, God. We're nothing without you, Lord. We have nothing without you, God. We have everything with you. We realize that, Lord, we trusted on you. Lord, we ask that you would be with those where death has come, God. Comfort their families. We thank you, Lord, for the testimony of this man that loved you and served you. Lord, he left behind a grieving family. I pray for them. And I pray for every request that's been made. Lord, I pray for John Hayward. Oh, God, help him and the family. Lord, Brother Hugh Sheridan. And Lord, I thank you for answered prayer in this church. How you've intervened on our behalf. You've made a way when there was no way. And you've restored and helped us, God. And I'm so grateful to you. So grateful for our pastor, for my brothers and sisters here. I watch over us and keep us safe, God, for the rest of this week. We tell someone we love about you. We don't want to see our neighbors die. And without you, Lord, we don't want to have their blood on our hands. God, let us be a witness for you and a light and salt to this earth. Lord, thank you for Brother Presley, how he brought your word tonight. God, your word is just true and it will return void. We know that, God. So thankful for you and my church family. Go with us, Lord. Keep us, God, our pastor, all our loved ones, and every family associated here tonight. In Jesus' name, I am.